फ्रेंड्स आई एम गोइंग टू स्पीक ऑन व्हाट्स न्यू इन एंटीनेटल केयर एंड यू ऑल माइट बी वंडरिंग व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू बिकॉज डे इन एंड डे आउट सिंस लास्ट 20 इयर्स 30 इयर्स 40 इयर्स यू ऑल आर टेकिंग केयर ऑफ आवर प्रेग्नेंट वुमन इज देयर समथिंग न्यू हैज रियली समथिंग न्यू कम इन दिस फील्ड लेट अस सी ट्रेडिशनली व्हाट वी ऑल यूज्ड टू डू We used to manage the problems after they develop. So, we used to treat the diseases once the pregnant lady starts suffering from that problem. Second, traditional approach was that all the problems or rather majority of the problems, they occur in the third trimester of pregnancy. So, the most intensive surveillance was diverted to the third trimester. I'm sure you all will identify with this pyramid. This is the traditional pyramid where we all used to have monthly visits, then both nightly visits and then weekly visits in the last trimester. What has changed? The approach towards this management has changed in the form of reverse inverted pyramid. What is this inverted pyramid? This inverted pyramid tells you that the majority of the problems you can identify and predict in the first trimester itself. So your this broad base instead of third trimester, it is in the first trimester that year you have to focus your intensive surveillance of this lady in the first trimester. And in the first trimester, if you divide your cases into low risk and high risk, you all will agree with me that sooner you diagnose that this patient is going to be a high-risk pregnancy, the better outcome in terms of maternal care and the perinatal care you can give it to the pregnant lady. Not only inverted pyramid, let us add a basement and a penthouse to this inverted pyramid. What do I mean by the basement? By basement, I mean the preconception care. And what does I mean by penthouse? It is the postnatal care. Don't leave that lady once the delivery is over. It is 6 weeks postpartum is your penthouse. So what is the preconception care? Because ideally we should start from the basement. If your foundation is strong, your building is strong. But I agree, majority of our women don't come to us in the preconception period. But we fertility specialists, we are lucky. All of our patients come to us in the preconception period. They want to become pregnant. They come to us for the treatment. And this generation is very knowledgeable. Majority of my young patients, they come to us that, madam, we want to become pregnant in coming 6 months or 1 year. And we have come to you for preconception counseling. So they are aware of the word preconception counseling and why it is so important. Remember, when your patient is pregnant, she is pregnant with her grandchild. What does I mean by this sentence? Because your patient is pregnant, if she is carrying a daughter inside her womb, that daughter is carrying the eggs with which that daughter will be born. And out of these eggs, her grandchild will be born. So, the eggs that may someday become the grandchild are developed inside the daughter while still she is in the womb of this pregnant lady. And these eggs of your daughter are going to be nourished by the diet and the environment of your pregnant patient. So this is the importance of preconception counseling. In just one slide, I have tried to summarize what all should be told to her in the preconception period. Of course, weight, BP, BMI, lifestyle counseling, garbh sanskar, folic acid supplementation, anemia correction if needed, basic tests like sugar, thyroid, endocrine factors if she is having. You have to give her targeted counseling and therapy and thalassemia screen wherever it is endemic and in high prevalence states. Vaccination counseling in preconception period is also very, very important. Foxy recommends vaccination counseling as a part and parcel of pregnancy counseling. You have to ask her the history of vaccines which she has taken, allergy to any vaccinations, And if she has not received, you have to give her rubella, hepatitis B, and varicella vaccination, preferably in the post-menstrual period. Pregnancy should be deferred for 3 months in case of rubella vaccine. Why we have to do antenatal surveillance? Aren't in old days they used to just get pregnant and deliver at home? Why at all we have to do antenatal surveillance? Friends, we have to do surveillance because we want to triage mothers into high risk and low risk. We want to screen the fetus for chromosomal abnormalities, structural defects, growth abnormalities. We want to predict and prevent the maternal and neonatal complications. And of course, we want to decide the time and mode of safe delivery. So with these goals, how are we going to proceed towards the surveillance? Let us see. This is a very straightforward case. She has come to us when she was just overdue by 10 days, 26 years old, natural conception, first trimester, first visit. So how you will go about it? She's just 10 days overdue. So you have to confirm the pregnancy. After that, you have to do the fetal well-being, the ultrasound to know that the baby is all right. You have to see for maternal weight, BMI. You have to do urine routine, all routine blood tests in the first visit itself. Maternal blood pressure, focus on having a mean arterial pressure. This is when she is just 10 days overdue. Now the pregnancy has advanced and she is around 10 weeks pregnant. So what is the recommended surveillance at this stage of gestation? I will be telling you the recommended surveillance in all the three trimester. First, let us focus on first trimester. The recommended things which we all are supposed to do is do her weight, blood pressure, hemoglobin, blood group and RH typing of both the partners. If you are not doing husband's group routinely, but if mother is RH negative, make it a point to document the husband's blood group and RH factor as well. Do routine microscopic VDRL, hepatitis B, HIV, TSH, DIPSI, in-first antenatal visit, dating scan, nuchal translucency, dual marker, and cervical length measurement. These are the recommended things which are supposed to be done for each and every pregnant woman in the first trimester. You can add BMI, the mean arterial pressure measurement, CBC, peripheral smear, electrophoresis, urine culture, HCV, rubella IgG, thyroid function, thyroid antibodies, vitamin D, HbA1c, Doppler, NIPT, and placental growth factor. This is preferable, but this is must. Now let us come one by one the importance of doing the extensive and intensive surveillance during first trimester and what all we can diagnose in the first trimester itself. First come to the fetal aneuploidies. Fetal aneuploidies is a cause of perinatal morbidity and mortality as well as long-term disabilities. All diagnostic prenatal tests, they used to diagnose aneuploidy. They carry a risk of miscarriage and are expensive. Therefore, you can't offer all the tests to all the pregnant women. You have to start with a screening test that has the highest possible detection rate and lowest possible false positive rate. So that is very, very important. So how to go about it? Until the advent of cfDNA technology, first trimester combined screening, that is maternal age and history, detailed history, gestational age, anti-measurement, FAPA, and free beta HCG performed at 11 to 13 weeks of gestation was arguably the most robust screening test for fetal aneuploidy available. These combined tests can identify more than 90% fetuses with trisomy 21. And the detection rate for trisomy 18 and 13 is about 95% for the same combined test. The effectiveness of this first trimester combined scan can be further augmented by the addition of other fetal markers such as nasal bone evaluation and Doppler evaluation of the ductus venosus and blood flow across the tricuspid wall. There is evidence that the effectiveness of the first trimester screening could also be further enhanced by including additional maternal serum markers such as placental growth factor and maternal serum alpha fetoprotein. So this was all about the aneuploidies. What about the structural defects in the first trimester? About half of the congenital structural defects can now be diagnosed in the first trimester because of the improvement in the ultrasound technology, because of the measurement of the nuchal translucency, the thickening, and the presence of other ultrasound markers can herald the presence of structural defects, and detailed evaluation of fetal anomaly is becoming widely recognized as an integral part of the first trimester ultrasound. I know we all do an anomaly scan at 18 weeks of gestation, but the early anomaly scan should be done in the first trimester itself. What structural defects we can identify in the first trimester? Once it was recognized that the appearance of anencephaly is different in the first trimester from that in the second trimester, early diagnosis of anencephaly has become routine. However, the diagnosis of open spina bifida has remained a challenge. This situation changed when it was recognized that examination and measurement of structures located in the posterior fossa can provide clues to the presence of open neural tube defects even in the first trimester. Friends, look at this study which was published in 2015 in a prospective multi-center first trimester screening study which included 15,500 normal fetuses and 11 fetuses with open spina bifida. All affected cases were identified or at least suspected by a detailed assessment of the posterior fossa at 11 to 13 weeks of gestation. This was the structural tubal open spina bifida. What about cardiac defects? Can you suspect or diagnose in the first trimester? Yes. The association between congenital cardiac defects and nuchal NT measurement is very well documented. In a meta-analysis that included 20 studies, the detection rate for major congenital heart disease based on NT measurement alone was estimated at 44% for a 5.5% false positive rate. Doppler evaluation of blood flow across the tricuspid wall and ductus venosus further improves the screening for congenital heart defect in the first trimester itself. Then the first trimester scan is very, very important for the exact dating of the pregnancy because the first trimester crown drum length measurement represents the most accurate method of establishing the gestational age in the general population. And the accurate gestational age is a critical piece of information that influences all your decisions as an obstetrician. What about multiple gestations, friends? First trimester ultrasound is very, very important here also because you all will agree that perinatal risk of morbidity and mortality is always increased in multiple gestation. However, the level of risk depends greatly on the chorionicity. And this chorionicity assessment is best accomplished in the first trimester as at this time, the ultrasound appearance of a dichorionic, diamniotic dividing membrane is vastly different from that of a monochorionic diamniotic membrane. This difference becomes blurred as the pregnancy advances, and the estimation of chorionicity in the first trimester allows accurate counseling regarding the risk of the pregnancy, because if you are diagnosing monochorionic monoamniotic pregnancy, if you are suspecting twin-twins transfusion syndrome later in the pregnancy, you can counsel the parents, they can opt for medical termination of pregnancy. So the determination of chorionicity in the first trimester itself in cases of multiple gestation is very crucial for both the patient and the doctors. Now I was telling you only about the aneuploidies, the structural defects, the congenital defects, the exact dating of the gestation and the chorionicity in the multiple gestation. What about the prediction of maternal fetal complications? Can we really predict them in the first trimester? Yes. Discussion regarding first trimester screening often focuses only on aneuploidies and structural anomalies. However, maternal and fetal complications that are related to abnormal placentation are much more common than both of these problems combined. Most placental architecture, including placental maternal blood circulation, is established by the end of the first trimester. No further anatomic modifications are evident after the fourth month of pregnancy. And these two facts serve to support the following two assertions. First, the validity of methods used at the end of first trimester in screening for placental dysfunction has a sound physiological basis. And second, in order of any treatment to be successful in reducing the risk of complications related to placental dysfunction, it must be instituted early in pregnancy. And the two often interrelated complications of pregnancy that are major causes of maternal fetal mortality and morbidity are preeclampsia and small for gestational age fetuses. A meta-analysis of 9 published studies have shown that the use of low-dose aspirin reduces the risk of preeclampsia, but only if you start the treatment before 16 weeks of gestation. And you can start treatment so early in the pregnancy if you predict that this pregnant lady is going to develop preeclampsia before 16 weeks of gestation. And this finding was confirmed in a more recent meta-analysis. So there are many meta-analyses which tells you that aspirin has to be started before 16 weeks of gestation to reduce the mortality and morbidity related to preeclampsia. First trimester screening for these complications. Meenal, please mute everyone. First trimester screening for these complications can be improved by using additional markers. One is the estimation of downstream resistance by measuring the pulsatility index in the uterine arteries. Second is the maternal blood pressure measurement in the late first trimester. And third is the evaluation of certain placental product levels in maternal serum such as PAPA and PIGF. Fetal Medicine Foundation algorithm suggests that detection of early preeclampsia will be approximately 90% based only on history, maternal blood pressure measurement, and uterine artery PI measurement. The addition of PAPA and PIGF level increases this detection rate to the tune of 96%. Please mute all of you. Please mute everyone.
Please mute.
So this was all about preeclampsia. I have told you that to the tune of 96% you can predict in the first trimester itself. What about SGA? The risk is increased with an increase in the uterine PA and PI and maternal mean arterial pressure, decreased maternal serum PAPA, pre-beta HCG, PIGF, placental protein 13 and A disintegrin and metalloproteinase 12 also increase the risk of SGA. For a false positive rate of 10%, the combination of these markers along with maternal characteristics could identify approximately 75% of SGF fetuses who has the risk of delivering before 36 of weeks of gestation and 45% who will deliver at term. So to the tune of 75%, you can predict SGA in the first trimester itself. What about the prediction of the risk of preterm delivery in the first trimester? Yes, we all have to make it a habit to measure the cervical length by transvaginal ultrasound in the first trimester itself. What about the screening for GDM in the first trimester? Yes, it is possible. Adiponectin and sex hormone binding globulin are reduced and bisphenin is increased in association with increased risk for GDM. Combination of maternal characteristics and biochemical markers can identify about 75% of pregnancies that will develop GDM later on for a 20% false positive rate. screening for fetal macrosomia and labs for gestational age using first trimester parameters has also shown some promise. Meenal, please support me.
Yes, madam, we are muting, they are getting unmuted.
The risk of LGA increases
in... Dr. Rita, who is... Please mute, madam.
The risk of LGA increases with increased anti-measurement, increased levels of maternal serum, pre-beta-HCG and PAPA, and a decreased level of adiponectin. For a 10% false positive rate, the combination of these factors and maternal characteristics can predict approximately 40% of large for gestational age fetuses in the first trimester itself. So friends, I'm sure by now you must have realized what we all can do in the first trimester itself by ultrasound, by Doppler, by biochemistry, by taking a detailed history, we can diagnose to the tune of 93 to 96% of problems which are going to manifest later in life. What about the second trimester surveillance? In the second trimester, the window is 18 to 24 weeks. The recommended things are repeat blood test, hemoglobin, TSH, urine dipstick, dipsy, quadruple or triple marker, do anomaly scan and repeat the cervical length measurement. Preferable that you should add NIPT, uterine artery Doppler, 3D, 4D scan and fetal echo at 22 weeks of gestation. Asymptomatic single pregnancies with a TVS of cervical length of less than 25 millimeter in second trimester, you know that the prognostic value of the prognosis for this measurement. Screen at 11 to 13 weeks with transvaginal ultrasound and then repeat at 22 to 24 weeks so that you can predict the preterm labor, the chances of preterm labor in this pregnancy itself. The recent evidence says that cervical stitch does not help and progesterone alone may be the treatment of option for preterm labor. But this should be individualized on case-to-case basis. So friends, with this combined first and second trimester screening, the detection rate increases to the tune of 97% with false positive rate of just 2.5%. Vaccination in pregnancy should never be forgotten in preconception period as well as when she comes to you when she is already pregnant. She should be given one dose of tetanus toxoid, Tdap or triple vaccine, second dose at 24 weeks. Influenza vaccine you can give from 24 weeks onwards. Hepatitis B can be given if she is not immunized. Targeted vaccine in case if she is planning to travel to endemic areas. And in the postpartum period, do counsel her for HPV vaccine. In the third trimester, the recommended are the repeat blood test, urine dipstick, TSH, dipsy, growth scan, Liker assessment, placental localization, and the fetal movements. Preferable is that you should add color Doppler, CTG, the BPP, that is modified the biophysical profile, and Doppler velocitometry. In the third trimester, the fetal surveillance takes the crux of our surveillance because we want to assess the fetal well-being in utero before the onset of labor. Early detection of fetus at risk, we want to identify so that timely management to prevent further deterioration can be taken. There are various methods for antepartum fetal surveillance. I just want to add one slide on a very common thing which we all should counsel our patient about, the kick chart. She has to count the kick count, count 10 movements every day, should be around 6 in 1 hour. If she is feeling less than 6 movements in 2 hours, she has to report to you for further assessment. This is available on the net. You all can have it in your native language. You can give it to the patient so that they understand what you are talking of and they can coordinate with you and cooperate with you in having a proper kick chart. This is the FOXI recommendations. We had the older ones in 2019. This was modified again in 2017. So we have the list for mandatory things should be done and preferable, that is things which can be done add-on to the mandatory things. So up to 10 weeks, FOXI recommends hemoglobin, blood group RS typing, screening for infections, urine routine, blood sugar, and at 11 to 14 weeks, NT scan. Preferable up to 10 weeks, you should do CBC and peripheral smear and TSH, dating scan, and at 11 to 14 weeks, on top of ultrasound NT scan, you add double marker to it. At 16 to 18 weeks, it is preferable to do a triple marker. 18 to 20 weeks, do a detailed anomaly scan. 24 weeks, do the GTT. At 32 to 34 weeks, repeat hemoglobin. And preferable is that you should do urine routine, ultrasound, growth scan, and at 38 to 41 weeks, do ultrasound. I'm sure we all are doing much more than this, but this is the very, very basic things which FOXI recommends for each and every pregnant woman in first trimester, second trimester, and third trimester. So friend, this is the last slide that what we all can do in the first trimester itself. We can diagnose the fetal aneuploidies so that you get time to counsel the patient and patient can have time to decide whether they want to continue or abort the pregnancy. You can identify the structural defects, neural tube defects, the congenital heart defects. You can decide the chorionicity if she is having the multiple gestation. You can do exact dating of the pregnancy. Not only that, you can predict many of the placental dysfunctions like preeclampsia because you have to predict it before 16 weeks so that you can start low dose aspirin. You can predict gestational diabetes, fetal growth restriction, the chances of preterm delivery, and if she is Rh negative, don't forget to add indirect Coombs test at the first antenatal visit. And in first trimester itself, if you predict, it will help you in giving the best possible outcome to this pregnant lady. So friends, again, I am coming back to my first slide. Traditional is this pyramid, but now what's new has come is that inverted pyramid. And to this inverted pyramid, you have to add the basement, that is preconception care. Don't forget to add the penthouse, that it take care up to 6 weeks of postpartum. Because I will say not only a child is born when she gives a mother, she gives birth, but a child gives birth to a mother. And let this be a very, very pleasant journey for this pregnant lady by giving her the best possible chance in the first trimester itself. So thank you, friends. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.